Good afternoon, colleagues. Can I remind members that social distancing measures are in place in the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus? I ask that members take care to observe these measures, including when entering and exiting the Chamber. Please only use the aisles and walkways to access your seat and when moving around the Chamber. The next item of business is portfolio questions, the first session being on social justice, housing and local government. I remind members that questions 5 and 7 are grouped together and that I'll take any supplementaries on these questions after both of them have been answered. I would also say that if a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button or indicate in the chat function by entering the letter R during the relevant question. And finally, in order to get as many members in as possible, I ask again for short and succinct questions and short and succinct answers. Call question number one, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to support the growth of social enterprises and other not-for-profit community enterprises.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robinson.
The Scottish Government's social enterprise strategy was launched in 2016 and sets out a wide-ranging, ambitious and long-term programme to develop the potential of Scotland's social enterprise sector. The latest Social Enterprise Action Plan was published on the 24th of March this year and covers the period 2021 to 2024.
Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for that answer. In conversations with community groups, it's highlighted that many of the available funding packages are project-based rather than intended for expanding or building on existing initiatives. And I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary could comment on perhaps their thoughts that they are not deemed sufficiently innovative, for example, if they want to expand for one of the funding streams or not being eligible for others because the project wasn't new.
Cabinet Secretary?
Well, I can write to the member with more details, but First Support delivers Scotland's national social enterprise startup incubator on behalf of the Scottish Government via the Social Entrepreneurs Fund, which also helps to not just start social enterprises, but also to develop and grow their ideas. And there's more information available about that on the website. We are looking to continue to fund social enterprises to make sure that they can continue to deliver beyond, obviously, the funding package that was delivered during the COVID period. We are continuing to fund social enterprises, and there is an additional £1.5 million to build on the successful programme of support offered through Adapt and Thrive, which helps community organisations wanting to diversify their income. So happy to write to the member with a bit more detail, particularly on this point about growing social enterprises.
Thank you. Question number two, Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on progress of its joint action plan with COSLA, improving the lives of Scotland's Gypsy Travellers 2019 to 2021.
Minister Ben McPherson.
Firstly, we welcome Ms Whittam's interest in this area, which I know she has from her days as COSLA's community spokesperson, and she was also an active member of the Scottish Government's Gypsy Traveller Ministerial Working Group. Due to the pandemic, the Gypsy Traveller Action Plan was extended until October 2022, providing us with more time to deliver on the remaining actions and to build on the excellent work already undertaken. In some areas, COVID-19 and the pandemic crisis has already allowed us to make unexpected progress. Areas such as remote and distance learning and digital access have improved, as well as our work to improve sites and accommodation. And we will continue to work closely with the community, COSLA and partners to ensure we meet our objectives and improve outcomes for our Gypsy Traveller communities.
Eleanor Whittam.
I thank the Minister for that answer. As well as seeing their traditional lifestyle eroded, we know our Gypsy Traveller communities often experiencing extreme and persistent stereotyping and hostility as they go about their lives. I know that the Minister will agree that this is hugely important, that we challenge such negative attitudes and ask what progress has been made to tackle racism and discrimination, which is a central part of the action plan.
Minister?
The member is right, and we are working hard to address racism, prejudice and discrimination against the community. For example, some of the practical steps we have taken include the development by NHS Fife and NHS 24 of an e-learning module to be promoted to tackle the stigma and discrimination some Gypsy travellers experience when using NHS services. Uptake of this module has been high, and this has also involved developing learning and development resources for Social Security Scotland staff to support the needs of Gypsy travellers when they access frontline services. And as the member will know, COSLA work with councillors across the country to raise awareness of the issues that Gypsy travellers face and how to ensure they feel involved in their local communities.
Thank you. Question number three, Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how much the Scottish Government is forecast to invest in social security support in the next 5 years.
Minister Ben McPherson.
As set out in this year's budget, we are committing £3.5 billion to social security payments that will reach over 800,000 people, money which will go directly to the people in Scotland who need it most. The latest Scottish Fiscal Commission's forecast, published in August 2021, estimate that annual social security spending will rise to £5.2 billion in 2026-27, totalling £23 billion over the next 5 years. The Scottish Government views social security as an investment in the people of Scotland and as a fundamental human right, and we are committed to making sure everyone can access the financial support that they are entitled to.
Siobhan Brown.
I thank the Minister for that answer. I welcome the introduction of the new benefits such as the Scottish Child Payment, which has helped over 2,000 families that need it the most in South Ayrshire alone since February. This morning, I received an email from my daughter's school advising parents of food shortages and that the local school was unable to provide the school lunches on the menu. We are living in the aftermath of a reckless Tory Brexit, which was forced through a global pandemic. With food prices rising, energy prices rising.
Could I please ask for a question? Thank you.
Yes, sure. Rising and empty shelves. Does the Minister share my deep concerns and agree that it is imperative that the people of Scotland get the opportunity to choose to determine their own future and rectify these injustices?
Minister?
First of all, with the powers that we do have, the Scottish Government has taken unprecedented action to tackle child poverty, investing nearly £1 billion in 2020-21 to support families with children. This includes, of course, our game-changing Scottish Child Payment, which we will double to £20 in the lifetime of this Parliament. Together with Best Start Grant and Best Start Foods, this will provide over £5,300 of financial support for families by the time their first child turns six. I completely agree with the member that our anti-poverty efforts are seriously undermined by UK government decisions and their unjustified assault on social security in too many cases. And I would take this opportunity to call on UK ministers again to do the right thing and reverse their planned £20 cut to universal credit and avoid pushing a further 20,000 children in Scotland into poverty.
Supplementary, Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The pandemic's demonstrated the negative impact of coping with bereavement, with families limited to how many people can attend funerals and people not being able to say a proper goodbye to their loved ones in care homes and hospitals. This has especially impacted those who provide care for a loved one. Can I ask the Minister, when did the Scottish Government therefore plan to bring forward the extension of carers' allowance for 6 months after a bereavement?
Minister?
As Mr Briggs will know, the delivery of devolved social security in Scotland has taken place over the last 3 years, and one of the first measures we took, which was stipulated in the 2018 Act, was the delivery of the carers allowance supplement, and we intend to give an additional supplement again this year like we did last year. We are, as I laid out to the committee last week, undergoing the process of appropriate stakeholder engagement and consultation on how we bring forward Scottish carers assistance, and we are looking at a range of different measures around eligibility and the experience of carers to make sure that we work together collectively with other parties and as a Parliament as a whole to make sure that Scottish carers assistance helps those unpaid carers that we all value and appreciate and want to deliver an enhanced benefit for in due course.
Question number four, Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its commitment to supporting the building of affordable homes for rent.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the Scottish Government is proud of our record on delivering more than 102,000 affordable homes, nearly 71,000 of which were for social rent, including more than 16,000 council homes since 2007. As the programme for government makes clear, we are committed to delivering 110,000 affordable homes by 2032, of which 70% will be available for social rent and 10% will be in our remote, rural and island communities. Delivering this ambitious affordable homes target would support a total investment package of around £18 billion and up to 15,000 jobs each year. In the 4 years to 2020, we delivered over 75% more affordable homes per head of population than in both England and Wales, and over nine times more social rented properties per head of population than in England.
Richard Leonard.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? Back in April 2020, the Auditor General told the government that it must, and I quote, evaluate the impact of the current programme on housing needs and the economic impact of the investment in affordable housing. In their 2021 action plan, Shelter Scotland say that the government's programme must be about more than simply the number of housing units completed. It must be about the social impact, about moving Scotland's communities in the right direction, and it must first and foremost be about reducing social housing need. So will the Cabinet Secretary today give a commitment to place before this Parliament on an annual basis a housing and social justice report to include whether housing need has gone up or down, the economic and social impact of the building programme, the state of housing need and access amongst groups all too often marginalised, as well as measures of wider community benefit and well-being?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member will hopefully be aware that Housing to 2040 talked about many of these issues, and that housing is not just about bricks and mortar, it's actually about a core anti-poverty measure, and I very much understand that. I think I was asked something along the lines of this when I attended the local government committee this week, and I said I would reflect on whether, in addition to the myriad of information that is provided on progress towards the affordable housing target, there's lots of statistics, lots of data, lots of reporting, whether or not additional reports would be of benefit to that. And I said I would go away and reflect on that. But I don't think anyone can say that an ambitious target of 110,000 affordable homes and a total investment package of £18 billion and the creation of 15,000 jobs each year is anything other than to be welcomed.
Question number five, Liz Smith.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the Rural Housing Fund.
Cabinet Secretary.
Between 2016-17 and 2019-20, the Scottish Government invested over £400 million through the Affordable Housing Supply Programme, including the Rural and Islands Housing Funds in rural and island communities, and delivered more than 4,800 affordable homes in that time. The Rural and Islands Housing Funds have been described in the Scottish Land Commission report as game changers for community-led housing development. We've committed to delivering 110,000 affordable homes by 2032, of which 10% will be in our remote, rural and island communities, backed by at least £45 million.
Liz Smith.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response? However, she's well aware that less than half of the £25 million fund set aside for rural housing has actually been spent, despite some of the chronic shortages of affordable housing in many parts of the countryside, and that there has been much faster progress for house building in the central belt rather than in rural areas. Could the Cabinet Secretary explain why this is the case and what is being done to rectify the situation?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I said in my initial answer, I think good progress has been made in delivering rural housing, and I talked about the 4,800 affordable homes in that time. However, Liz Smith will be aware of some of the particular challenges in remote and rural Scotland: land availability, community capacity to bring forward the proposals, and making sure that they can get to the pre-development to development stage. These are quite complex matters, which is why, however, in recognition that we needed to do more, we have committed to develop a rural and remote housing plan dedicated to the needs of rural and remote Scotland. That consultation will talk to communities the length and breadth of Scotland to make sure that we can get it right in every community, even where it's small-scale developments. And, of course, that is backed up by the additional resources that we've made available.
Question number seven, Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken to tackle the reported shortage of housing in rural areas.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I said earlier, this Government has significantly invested in affordable housing and delivered 4,800 homes between 2016-17 and 2019-20 as part of the £3.4 billion affordable housing supply programme, as well as the 10% target of the 110,000 homes. We are committed to developing a Remote Rural and Islands Action Plan. Councils are also being given significant additional powers to manage some of the particular challenges in communities like short-term lets, and we'll be laying legislation for a licensing scheme in November. And, of course, we're giving local authorities powers to deal with second homes when they see this as a problem in their area.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. Given that the population of rural areas has grown and now accounts for 17% of Scotland's population, does the Cabinet Secretary think that the 10% she referred to of the target 110,000 is frankly going to be adequate, because that's simply about 1,000 properties a year, and we have big challenges when it comes to labour vacancies in rural areas, and one of the biggest barriers is access to affordable housing. Surely we should be planning to build more houses to tackle that challenge?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would see that the 10% as a minimum, and I think through the Rural and Remote Housing Plan we will get more of a sense and evidence of what the actual housing need is. I want to take a more strategic approach to looking at the housing needs in remote and rural Scotland. We have been relying on community organisations and community responses to come forward with proposals, and sometimes that is quite difficult because of the complexity of doing so. So we want to assist communities to analyse and agree what the housing needs and priorities are, and then work with them and with local authorities and social landlords to work up plans to deal with those shortages.
Supplementary, Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline what action is being taken to reduce the impact the huge increase in short-term lets is having on the availability of rural housing, an issue which is of major concern of those living in these areas?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can say to the member that our licensing scheme will ensure all short-term lets across Scotland comply with basic safety standards to protect guests and neighbours. Local authorities will have discretion to add further licence conditions to address any local concerns such as littering or overcrowding of properties. The licensing scheme will provide local authorities with data on the number, type and location of short-term lets in their areas. And of course, they can designate short-term let control areas if they wish to do so, in order to address pressures created by secondary short-term letting. And within a control area, planning permission would always be required in order to let out a whole home for short-term lets. And finally, this will allow local authorities to manage high concentrations of secondary letting where it affects the availability of residential accommodation or the character of a neighbourhood.
Supplementary from Beatrice Wishart, please.
The shortage of housing is not just a rural issue but an island one. What actions being taken to tackle island housing shortages, which disproportionately affect young people and is a significant factor in island depopulation?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I very much appreciate this, and the Remote Rural and Island Housing Plan will absolutely look at the needs of island communities. It can also look at how we use the island bonds as part of the response to that. I just this morning met with the leader of Shetland Council to talk about many issues, and this was one of the issues that we explored, and we'll be having further discussions about that as we take these matters forward.
Thank you. Question number 6 from James Dornan, who is joining us remotely. Mr Dornan.
To ask the Scottish Government what progress it is making on reducing child poverty.
Cabinet Secretary.
So tackling child poverty is a national mission, and this is shown through the almost £1 billion of targeted investment we provided last year. Our Scottish child payment has reached 108,000 children already, and combined with our bridging payments will provide over £130 million directly to families this year. But we'll go further and double the Scottish Child Payment to £20 a week as soon as we can put the budgetary provisions in place. And this complements wider action across government, from the 1140 hours of funded early learning and childcare to the expansion of free school meals and increasing the school clothing grants, all examples of positive steps this government is taking to tackle child poverty.
James Dornan.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. And does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me Scottish Child Payment has already made significant strides towards reducing child poverty, not just in Scotland, but for the 58,520 payments made to Glasgow families, totalling £2,895,000, and it demonstrates the Scottish Government's progressive thinking as opposed to the regressive universal credit cuts that the UK Government is callously pursuing?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I agree with the member that the Scottish Child Payment has been acclaimed as a game changer in the fight against child poverty, projected to lift thousands of children out of poverty, and the member outlined how that is impacting positively on Glasgow families. But this policy is being completely undermined by the UK Government's regressive £20 cut to universal credit, which will be the biggest overnight cut to welfare in 70 years. 60,000 families across Scotland, including 20,000 children, could be pushed into poverty. We've urged the UK Government to reverse their plans on numerous occasions, including most recently with the Welsh and Northern Ireland governments.
And we have a supplementary from Pam Duncan-Glancy, who should be joining us remotely. Please go ahead with your supplementary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Citizens Advice have said that 4,000 families will lose eligibility to the Scottish Child Payment if the abhorrent cut to universal credit goes ahead. Will the Scottish Government commit today to continuing to pay the Scottish Child Payment to those families?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, as I said, the UK Government cutting the £20 a week uplift to universal credit could reduce the number of children eligible for the Scottish Child Payment, estimated around 2,000. And for some families, the universal credit cut will be enough to remove their entitlement to Scottish Child Payment. But the problem here is that we rely on top-up powers to deliver those payments. We don't have any other legislative basis in order to do so. So what I would call for is the UK Government not to cut the £20 per week uplift to universal credit. We want people to remain eligible for a Scottish Child Payment, but because they're delivered through the top-up powers, we are very constrained with what we're able to do for those families.
Supplementary, Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It is deeply disappointing that the Scottish Government have yet again failed to commit to pay the Scottish Child Payment in the next fiscal year in the way that all other parties have committed to, civic society has committed to, and the faith communities have committed to. And of course, the answer is because independence is on my mind and there is room for nothing else. Can the Minister explain why the Government insists on continually putting the constitutional obsession over the wellbeing of our young people?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I find it astonishing that a Tory MSP would come to this chamber to demand that the Scottish Government double the Scottish Child Payment this year in the very month... that his government, that Jeremy Balfour's government, is going to remove £20 a week... £20 a week...
Excuse me, Cabinet Secretary, could you maybe resume your seat for a second?
Yes.
I don't want shouting across the chamber, please. Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, please resume.
I think I might have touched a raw nerve, Deputy Presiding Officer, here. Every time a Tory MSP comes to this chamber and utters the words child poverty, I will be reminding them of what their government is about to do this very month in cutting £20 a week from some of the most vulnerable families. Get your own house in order before coming here and demanding that we do anything. Get your own house in order. It's an absolute disgrace and a total brass neck.
Question number eight, Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on establishing a commission to prevent violence against women in all its forms.
Cabinet Secretary.
Violence against women and girls is one of the most devastating and fundamental violations of human rights and is totally unacceptable. Rather than establishing a commission to tackle it, we are committed to delivering against the Equally Safe strategy and continuing our collaborative work with a wide range of partners in the sector via the Equally Safe Joint Strategic Board. We have also tasked the Independent Working Group on Misogyny and Criminal Justice in Scotland with evaluating how the Scottish criminal justice system deals with misogyny, including looking at whether there are gaps in the law.
Alex Gough-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for that reply. Earlier in the year, when Scottish Liberal Democrats suggested the idea of a commission to prevent violence against women and girls, the government agreed that they would certainly be willing to explore the idea of a commission with an open mind, and that a commission might help bring all of the strands of work together. And statistics published this week, Deputy Presiding Officer, are showing that in 2021, 1,045 stalking charges were reported to Crown Office. Of these, 592 were identified as domestic abuse. I am dismayed to hear the Cabinet Secretary...
Could we get to the question, please, Mr Gough-Hamilton?
..suggest there won't be a commission. And I would ask her to explain to the Chamber why they have decided not to embark on such a commission.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, look, the member is aware of all of the work that is going on in this area. I've described in my first answer the work that's going on around the Equally Safe strategy. I've also described the work of the Working Group on Misogyny and Criminal Justice. And there also is the review of the law that is going on in this area. And the Minister for Community Safety has also been looking at what further areas of the law require reform. I don't think anyone could really accuse the government of not taking action across all of these areas. And you know, there's not that we have an in principle objection to a commission. We just think that this work is being taken forward already through these other platforms. And hopefully the member will engage constructively in those discussions.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And we'll now move on to the next portfolio of questions, which is on Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. And I would firstly ask all members who may be seeking to participate in this portfolio of questions, including backbenchers and frontbenchers, if they could ensure that the card is in their console. Secondly, again, if a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button or indicate so in the chat function by entering the letter R during the relevant question. I turn to question number one, Rachel Hamilton.
To ask the Scottish Government what support it can offer Borderlands Region with its bid to be UK City Culture 2025.
And I call on Minister Jenny Gilruth, who is joining us remotely. Ms Gilruth.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I wish the Borderlands, Tay Cities region and Stirling all the best in the long-listing stage of the UK City of Culture competition. My officials met with the Borderlands bid team on the 23rd of August to hear about the content of the bid and to discuss useful connections that Scottish Government officials could help to facilitate, for example, with Visit Scotland, to allow them to be on the front foot if long-listed. And I understand the long-listed bids will be announced later this month.
Rachel Hamilton.
I thank Jenny Gilruth for that answer, and I wish the other three bids, Scottish bids, all the very best too. We in the Borderlands are very well placed to showcase what we have in the borders, build on the cross-border and cross-party collaboration. On the UK and Scottish Government growth deal, we need to link our intrinsic cultural, historical and societal links and draw international attention to the region. But I would like to ask the Cabinet Secretary, in the spirit of learning lessons from the previous Paisley bid several years ago, what support and guidance the Scottish Government might be able to offer this exciting new Borderlands bid?
Minister.
I thank Rachel Hamilton for her supplementary. I recognise, of course, her constituency interest in the matter, and I note that she wrote in July, I think, to the UK Government's Culture Minister on this. It is a UK Government policy in which she will note that there is an expert panel which will select six bids to receive support to develop a longer bid. In July, I signed off on the appointment of Roberta Doyle to the expert panel as Scotland's representative. And I note that DCMS has stated that they hope for a representative geographical spread in terms of the shortlisting. If Scottish bids have been shortlisted previously, but no Scottish bid has yet been successful in securing the title, indeed the member will recall the amount of hard work which went into Paisley's bid that she mentioned. My officials have been in contact with the bidding team from the Borders Link, and we will continue to have those conversations. And I look forward to seeing the long list at the end of this month and hoping to see, of course, a Scottish representation in the final list.
Question number two, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In a very similar vein, can I ask the Scottish Government how it will support the bids from the Tay Cities region and Stirling to be the UK City of Culture 2025?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My officials have already met with representatives from the Stirling bid and have sent a note of introduction to the Tay Cities team offering to meet. The Tay Cities team have advised my officials they'll be back in touch if they are longlisted to arrange a further discussion. Scottish Government officials have liaised closely with the relevant UK Government team throughout the design and implementation process to ensure that Scottish interests are represented.
Myrta Fraser.
Can I thank the Minister for her response? Mid-Scotland and Fife Region has two bids to be UK City of Culture 2025. So can I ask the Minister how Scottish Government funding for cultural projects across the region will assist in supporting these important bids being taken forward?
Minister.
I thank Myrta Fraser for his supplementary. As previously stated, the UK City of Culture programme is a UK Government-sponsored competition, but the Scottish Government's approach to working with DCMS on the UK City of Culture 2025 competition was signed off on by the previous Cabinet Secretary in a letter to Oliver Dowden as Culture Secretary, agreeing, of course, that Scottish Government officials would work with DCMS officials on the design and the implementation of the process, which I spoke to in my response to Rachel Hamilton. And as I understand it, the Stirling bid is purely for Stirling itself, while the Tay Cities bid takes an Angus, Dundee, North East Fife, Perth and Kinross. And I won't ask Mr Fraser to pick a side, given that I know he represents both areas. But likewise, I hope he'll understand I'd be keen at this stage to support all Scottish bids as they move forward. I would wish the Stirling and the Tay Cities deals the best of luck. And in terms of funding, I just note that if Mr Fraser has any influence, he may wish to raise with his Conservative colleagues in Westminster the outstanding culture consequentials, which are due to the Scottish Government a sum total of £31 million, on which, of course, the culture sector in Scotland are in dire need of just now.
Question number three, Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with the UK Government regarding the impact of Brexit on Scotland's ability to import essentials such as food and medicine.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
Thank you. Brexit has led to significant challenges, including labour and skills shortages, which could have an impact on supplies of food and of other goods. It was an astonishing act of recklessness by the UK Government to press ahead with a hard Brexit in the middle of a pandemic, and they did so despite the Scottish Government providing detailed evidence of the damage this would cause. We're doing whatever we can to mitigate the harms being inflicted on Scottish businesses. The Scottish Government has, at an official and ministerial level, attended 29 EU Exit Operations Committee meetings since the 1st of January to discuss the impacts of Brexit with the UK Government.
Colette Stevenson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. I've been contacted by constituents who are extremely worried about the consequences of Brexit on the recognition of UK prescriptions in the EU and with imports going through customs controls. Will the Cabinet Secretary urge the UK Government to rectify these problems?
Cabinet Secretary.
From the 1st of January 2021, UK-issued prescriptions are no longer valid in the European Union, except in Ireland and Spain, where separate arrangements apply. Prescription charges can be applied to UK citizens by pharmacists in both of these countries. The Scottish Government continues to work closely with the UK Government regarding the impact of EU exit on the import of medicines in the event of any border disruption. I'd also choose to stress to my friend that there is, of course, a solution to all of this, which is at the soonest and practical point, we should ensure that we rejoin the European Union so we don't need to go through the continuing woes that Brexit is causing to our economy and so many communities the length and breadth of this country.
Question number four has not been lodged. Question number five, Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it will establish the new overseas offices in Warsaw and Copenhagen as set out in its agreement with the Scottish Green Party.
Minister Jenny Gilruth.
As announced in the programme for government, we will open a Scottish Government office in Copenhagen next year to increase Scotland's economic and cultural visibility in the Nordic region. Over the lifetime of this Parliament, we will also open an office in Warsaw as part of our continued commitment to enhancing our external reach and voice.
Dean Lockhart.
I thank the Minister for that answer. As the Minister will be aware, 32 out of 38 of the Scottish Government's existing international offices are located within British embassies and consulates. As the Minister will also be aware, more than 60% of Scotland's trade is with the rest of the UK, but there is only one investment and trade office in that market that accounts for 60% of Scotland's trade. So let me ask the Minister, when will this Government take steps such as opening trade offices to support and increase Scotland's trade with the rest of the UK?
Minister.
Well, In response to Dean Lockhart's question, Scotland's international network has been supported by ministers from a range of political parties for decades, and I hope that we're not going to see a politicisation of this issue in the future. Going back to 1992, Scotland Europa was established in Brussels under a Conservative administration, and Washington and Beijing were opened under the Labour-Lib Dem coalition. Scotland's international presence is even more important now in the wake of Brexit, of course, which we did not vote for, and the damage that is causing to our economy, jobs and trade. Our network of international offices promotes Scotland's enterprise internationally. Indeed, work to attract investment by our offices both at home and overseas has helped to increase foreign direct investment into Scotland by 6% in 2020.
Supplementary from Eleanor Whittam.
The establishment of new overseas offices will play an important role in developing Scotland's international relationships. Can the Minister provide an update as to what further action the Scottish Government is taking to strengthen Scotland's international presence and voice?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Our international presence creates domestic opportunities, broadens our horizons, attracts investment and ultimately benefits the people of Scotland. Our policies and actions abroad will be consistent with our focus on fairness and inclusion at home. The programme for government emphasises our commitment to reviewing our approach to future policy and economic engagement with a view to enhancing Scotland's global reach and presence.
Question number six, Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, in light of its cooperation agreement with the Scottish Green Party, whether it will provide an update on its position on maintaining the monarch as the head of state in an independent Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I begin with commending Douglas Lumsden for his implied recognition that there will be an independence referendum. I think that's extremely welcome. As the cooperation agreement between the Scottish Government and the Scottish Green Party parliamentary group makes clear, each party continues to have the right to set out their own vision for independence. The Scottish Government's view remains clear. Scotland will remain a constitutional monarchy with the Queen as head of state, just as she is in a great many other independent Commonwealth countries.
Douglas Lumsden.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response, but does he agree with the First Minister's adviser, Mark Blyth, that unwinding centuries of economic integration would prove devastating to businesses in the short, medium and long term? And would he further agree with me that Scotland is best placed to succeed in the short, medium and long term, politically, economically and socially, with both the monarch as head of state and the union as the defender of Scotland's interests?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the General obviously needs to reread his history. Scotland was, of course, part of a treaty involving the crowns for 100 years before the Treaty of Union saw the end of the Scottish Parliament. As the First Minister set out, work on a detailed independence prospectus will now be taken forward in line with the democratic mandate which has been secured for a referendum. For the record, if it needs any more stressing, the parties that were committed to a democratic choice in the recent Scottish Parliament elections won the election, while the parties that opposed the referendum lost. We will determine how the work towards those referendum will proceed, and as we do for delivering our commitments across the whole range of our responsibilities in the interests of the people of Scotland.
Question number seven, Katie Clark.
To ask the Scottish Government what work it has done to assess how many Afghan refugees can be housed across all local authority areas.
Cabinet Secretary.
Scotland will play its part in welcoming refugees from Afghanistan. We are undertaking urgent work with the Home Office, the Convention of Scottish local authorities directly and other partners to assess the contribution that Scotland can make. Local authorities assess their ability to provide accommodation and services. Offers are then matched with refugees accepted for resettlement by the Home Office on the basis of their needs. We're keen to explore all avenues to provide suitable housing. However, we need detailed information from the UK Government to be able to progress work to identify suitable accommodation and service availability to meet the needs of people who are arriving.
Katie Clark.
I thank the Minister for that answer, and it would be useful if you could keep the Parliament updated on the number of refugees who come to Scotland, and if you could perhaps give more detail on the money that was announced last week and how that will be spent. As he knows, the work that's been done on refugees previously has been funded by the Home Office. So could he perhaps outline what work he is now doing to look at the pressures on councils and what can be done by the Scottish Government to provide help with wider support services?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first of all, can I commend Katie Clark in the question that she's asked and the positive way in which she has put them. I welcome the questions that she has raised greatly. I held conversations on Monday with the new UK minister with responsibility for Afghan refugee resettlement. It was a very positive meeting, but I want to be clear, I asked the very same questions that Katie Clark asked about funding, both in terms of direct funding and Barnett consequentials. Unfortunately, I have had no detailed breakdown of any commitments from the UK government following on from that conversation. So I will continue to press the UK government. We need answers on that point. On the issue she raises in terms of pressures and local authorities, that's absolutely right. And that's why we need to understand the financial sides of the equation, but then there's also the issue of numbers which she addressed. And if I can just put one simple fact into the debate that we're having around this issue to understand the scale of the challenge. An average Afghan family size is bigger than six. And we want to make sure that Afghan families remain united. And it doesn't take a genius to work out that it is a challenge to find in our housing stock houses that are appropriate for people in those circumstances. So we're going to do absolutely everything that we can. I appreciate people want hard and fast numbers, but it's a fast-moving situation. We're trying our best to identify housing stock that's available, work with local authorities, get the resources in place, and doing the best we can to maximise the number of people that we can take up in Scotland.
Supplementary, Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Considerable concerns have been raised about the impact which the Home Office's Nationality and Borders Bill may have on vulnerable individuals seeking sanctuary in Scotland and elsewhere in the UK. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that the Bill's proposals are flawed and risk creating further barriers to vulnerable people seeking protection?
Cabinet Secretary?
Yes, I do. The UK Government's Nationality and Borders Bill is deeply flawed and it will not create an immigration system which is effective, efficient and delivers for the most vulnerable. The Bill will differentiate between people based on how they entered the UK, not the protection that they need. The Scottish Government recognises the need to deter and prevent abuse of our immigration and asylum systems. However, extremely vulnerable people, including children and victims of human trafficking, deserve a system which enables access to the support they desperately need, not one which erects barriers. This bill puts Scotland's reputation as a country of welcome and of refuge at serious risk. The Scottish Government will continue to make the case for immigration and asylum systems that treat people compassionately and with the dignity and fairness at all times.
Question number 8, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it is supporting the cultural sector's recovery in the current financial year, including the provision of funding.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much. Since the start of the pandemic, the Scottish Government has provided £175 million to the culture, heritage and events sector, far more than we have received in consequentials from the UK Government. This includes £25 million that was announced in June 2021 for the Cultural Organisations and Venues Recovery Fund and the Performing Arts Venues Relief Fund. We've created reopening of cultural performances and events guidance and will continue to revise it to ensure it remains relevant to the sector. We'll continue to work with the whole culture sector, building on new relationships and existing relationships to understand the immediate challenges it faces as it returns to full capacity. We'll work with the sector to consider how to build a resilient future, recognising that different parts will be affected in different ways.
Kenneth Gibson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Pre-pandemic, there was a huge discrepancy in the disbursement of funds in support of the culture sector. And, of course, we do acknowledge that large cities do have some national collections. But even so, Glasgow received 25 times the funding per capita of North Ayrshire. Can the Cabinet Secretary therefore confirm that as we build back better, such discrepancies will be tackled?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much. We know how valuable culture is and we're committed to continuing to provide access to culture for communities and creative workers across Scotland as we rebuild from the pandemic. We continue to invest in programmes with broad reach across Scotland, such as the Youth Music Initiative and Culture Collective. Cultural venues across Scotland, including a number of North Ayrshire-based recipients, have received funding through the Culture Organisations and Venues Recovery Fund over the course of the pandemic, which has been an important step in supporting cultural organisations and venues in navigating these extremely challenging times.
Thank you, and that concludes portfolio questions, and I will allow a very short pause before moving on to the next item of business to allow anybody moving seat to do so now. Thank you.